Okay, so today I think think I'm going to try to watch a I don't really think I watch many of these. I mean, usually I watch either Japanese horror or South Korean horror. Now occasionally I watch Western horror as well, but yeah. Now this is still in the area, but last time I watched anything from this country, Thailand, it was a comedy horror. Now this does not have any comedy in this genre, so the title certainly doesn't sound comedic at all. It's called Cadaver, and yeah, you cannot possibly have comedy with such a title. Hopefully it's not too gruesome, but then based on what I've watched recently, I don't think, I mean, at this point it's a question of whether it's more or less gruesome than what I've watched recently. Based on the title, it could be more, but yeah, anyway, we'll see. But all I know, it could be something like Kuchiyonna 2, which is only gruesome at the end, really, mostly, and mainly a drama. You never know, could be Dark Water. And yeah. I guess this will be a frightener or whatever they're called. I really dislike those. I mean, you know, it's they look as bad as gore, but they do feel as cheap, you know, the same way go directors seem to think that gore is somehow horrifying in itself, you know, it's mostly just disgusting. This, on the other hand, well, I mean, it's not as prevalent as gore, but some seem to think that, you know, frightening people with sudden things is horror. It's a fright, it's not horror. There's a difference between a fright and horror, you know. Real horror is what creeps up, really. I mean, yeah, I guess it is. But that's the point. It's not about, I mean, if something just abruptly faces you, then it's not creeping up. It's just abruptly doing that. On the other hand, something like The Ring does creep up, literally, slowly. Of course, horror can be anything that's creepy, any feeling, something like darkness that creeps up. When there's no light, you know, like candles being extinguished or something. But yeah, clearly it seems like it wants to be a fright or whatever. In the first 2 minutes as well. Hopefully it doesn't have many others of them. It's kind of funny though that the old lady just told her, yeah, we have some stranger staying with us. It's not made clear whether it's an inn or not. That would be the most logical conclusion. Otherwise, it's just bizarre. Yeah, we have a stranger. We didn't get any details, but we have a. Yeah, they're staying here. Yeah. But. Yeah, she's definitely too squeamish to do this, I suppose. I mean, yeah, personally, I wouldn't like doing it, so I wouldn't do it. But. I don't think I'd faint. I just wouldn't do it in the first place, though. I really have no career in that direction. None whatsoever. Absolutely. And yeah, that phone call was the epitome of uncaring, really. I mean, what's the point of asking someone how they are and not even give them a chance to reply before saying, yeah, I'm busy, I'm going to hang out. Just don't ask. Yeah, I think it's better not to ask in that case. I'm surprised they even let her in again, Annie. I'm surprised she wanted to go in again. What's the point? Of course she was going to end up in a similar situation and affecting the environment around. I don't get what some people are in for. I know what I like and what I don't like, and I just don't do things I don't like mostly. Mostly, I suppose. Because I do watch at times, movies that I don't like, but movies are quite different from something so visceral. All movies are on screen, that's the main difference, as opposed to an actual, physicality in reality. So it's a bit strange in this sense, because to make things worse, she's alone in a house apart from a stranger. And that's cool. I'm assuming this is on the syllabus or something, but okay. Well, clearly they should have exemptions. I can't see how it can work otherwise. It's not exactly maths, where it's all abstract.
By the way, subtext is just describe this as emotions transmissions. I think the translation and transmissions isn't working very well, I suppose. I've seen worse, to be fair, with subtitles, but I think this is the most egregious emotions transmissions. Huh. And these two guys here, they're trying to convince her to only believe, what she can see in front of her. And I see a flaw in such an argument, many flaws. I mean, first of all, one cannot quite just tell people to see only see something, if they happen to see something else, kind of like, colorblind people cannot be told to just see color. It just doesn't matter. Similarly, schizophrenia exists. Hallucinations exist. And they are as physical as reality. And they seem to be forgetting that. I mean, sure, if she is hallucinating, then she still cannot very much be a doctor. Otherwise, ultimately, people need to decide that based on what they think is ideal. But I don't think it's a simple thing about beliefs, is it? It's not like she's the only one in the whole room for believe something, but most people are still not so hypersensitive to such things or outright hallucinating. So clearly, there is something else going on other than just belief. I like how it's tinged all blue, as if somehow blue is the predominant color for some reason in all of this environment and possibly country. I mean, no, it's not always like that, but mostly it is. You rarely see other sort of colors. Sort of reminiscent of Boogie Pop Phantom, which does it itself. I think it was gray in that series, not blue. I suppose gray is sort of more horror related, but any color, I guess, can become sort of, you know, just like I think Dario Argento used red mainly to do that. So really, any color can, of course, red can easily be inferred as see, even the word there, inferred, you know, so sort of similar to inferno. Yeah, red can easily be, you know, the color of fire and such. Yeah. And as it happens, very coincidentally, they share a name, huh? So I'm guessing now they're going to say that she's possessing her because they have the same name or something, or she's just following her along because she has the same name. What's a bit unbelievable is that she seemed to access her memories as well. I mean, unless suddenly she knows everything about it. Not sure what that flashback was. Yeah. And what do you know? That after 1 hour and 8 minutes, the so-called Noi shows up. Because I was wondering throughout whether she was the one staging all this. And of course, in reality, there's many possibilities. You know? Like, you know, what happened there. Just before shows up, what happened there is very similar to what people experience as parasomnias, you know, like sleep paralysis, and that's where Incubus was developed, really, the idea that something heavy is on top and suffocating the sleeper. Of course, in reality, it's the mind being half awake and half asleep. Of course, in the context of this fiction, someone happens to have died, you know, haunting her. Still can't figure out who Ning was, though. I'm assuming at this point, She's the same Mai all along, but who's Ning then? I don't get it. That's the one thing that's confusing me. But from what I can understand, apparently she is the landlord's daughter. But how is she related to Mai's former boyfriend? I don't get it. So Noi finally shows up, and she seems to be more sensible than I thought she would be if she was staging all this. It would be difficult to stage, though, like there were all the 3 hallucinations and such. How do you do it, I suppose? Because you could have the invisible speakers exist, I don't know, some sort of transmitter. In the middle of the room, makes it seem like it's coming from nowhere. Yeah. By the way, the subtitle seems to think that very is spelled very. I mean, pretty much every instance of very is very, so it's not just a temporary typo. Strange, I'm sure they actually think that it's spelled that way, or just happens. Yeah, if somebody else confirms your hallucination, is it like a shared hallucination? I don't get it. So, if multiple people can see a single ghost, is it like a ghost in objective reality? What are movies making one think? By the way, should mention, I absolutely love the music. The soft singing there, it's so tranquil in such a adrenaline, not quite, you know, so in comparison to, you know, movies that, you know, for the so-called splatter genre, is nothing, but no, I mean, you know, the occasional
adrenaline sort of, you know, moments, which there are many, but you know, it's at least you don't still try to, you know, just get up to your face, you know, out of nowhere. They do crawl just a bit as well. But yeah, the music is so lovely. It's like an ocean just swaying back and forth. And yeah, I finished it, and it was well constructed overall. It wasn't too bad. It wasn't too stereotypical, although it was kind of, but could have been worse, I suppose. I mean, most horror films have some elements that are present here, except they don't even have the pretext of it being set in a medical school, you know, which sort of makes more sense, you know, considering certain things happening. The only spurious thing that seemed to happen is the fact that he thought, and this is obviously a spoiler, but you know, he thought that she needed to be killed, you know, and to that Ning specifically needed. Obviously, the other one, you know, knew that he killed her. But I mean, why would he feel the need to kill Ning in the first place, whoever she was? Just because, apparently, from what I can understood through the subtitles that were a bit broken, from what I understood, she was going to tell people that he covered up for my pushing her boyfriend off. But you know, I don't know if there was CCTV or something that could have, you know, indicted her on pushing him off. But it seemed to be, you know, somewhere in between. So you know, it didn't seem like she wanted to push him off. She was going to just grab him, to, you know. But then, you know, there happened to be stairs, and you know, I don't suppose you can really say that, you know, she intended to do it. So I'm not sure why they even constructed this whole thing about the professor helping her to cover it up, because she didn't really intend to do it, it seems, and you know, anyone could really see that in this sense. I mean, there wasn't this force, you know, if someone intends to push someone, you know, just push. She seemed to want to grab the person to stop her actually from going instead of pushing. So, you know, I don't know why, you know, and then the fact that, you know, well, just the basic sort of fact is, yeah, it's a bit spurious, but otherwise, I suppose it sort of makes sense. As I said earlier, for the music is, yeah, pretty much the best, along with this blue sort of hue that pervades the entire thing. It sort of gave it a certain mood that I don't think I ever noticed was present in any movie. Because yeah, usually I think red is more associated with horror. I suppose, you know, it's the color of blood as well, color of fire, so red is more that, and blue isn't so much, you know, because blue is associated with the sky and such, which obviously isn't very horrific usually, unless it's, you know, dark blue maybe, you know, thunderstorms and such. But yeah, it was interesting. Clearly, it shows that I'm not sure if Thailand is predominantly associated with comedic horror. So, you know, I've read some comments that seem to imply that it was. So far, I've only watched sort of one of each, I guess one could say. And you know, the comedic horror was interesting, but so was this. So I mean, they can do pure horror as well. I mean, you know, it didn't have too many frighteners. Then only one, the worst was at the beginning, and then sort of tapered off. It wasn't too bad. Yeah, only the subtitles were a bit broken. Yeah, it wasn't too bad. It wasn't amazing, but you know, it was mediocre, but bit better than mediocre maybe. It was equivalent to most horror I've watched.